believe that your spirit is going to move swiftly today. Lord, we are expecting miracles to happen today. We are expecting salvation to happen today, that lost people will be coming home. Lord, we just pray that this invitation to come into your presence, Lord, would be gentle and it would be swift, that people would come into your presence, Lord.
There's no limit to your love. There's no limit to your love. You make me new. You make me new. There's no limit to your love. There's no limit to your love. You make me new. You make me new. Restore my soul and lead me home. Fix my eyes on you alone. Restore my soul and lead me home. Fix my eyes on you alone.
Let's welcome everyone that's watching online. Come on. Let's welcome Maze Landing in the house tonight. Summers Point, come on, let's put our hands together. Man, we're excited. And so worship was come let us adore him. And so this week, I was running around, like probably every single one of us, getting stuff done, trying to get things done here, and finishing up from ACIT and the incredible services we had there. And so Wednesday, I was in Ocean City and was coming back towards this area and was going to meet my wife, and we were going to exchange vehicles so that she could go do her thing and then I could do what I needed to do with a different vehicle, okay? And so got here to the church, and it's kind of like one of those things like you're running 5 minutes behind. Anyone ever been there? You're running 5 minutes behind, let's be honest, okay? And pull up, skew in the parking space, you know, and hop out. She is in another vehicle, and I remember I need my laptop bag, so I open the vehicle, pull out my laptop bag, put it in this vehicle, and then I turn around to make sure that I can get the rest of the things, and I pull at the door, and it's locked. And what do you do next? You pull at the next door, and then you pull at the 4 doors later, it's locked. The keys are inside and it's running because it's cold outside. And I thought I'm going to keep it running for my wife so that she can get in. Seat warmers are still on, you know, cozy kind of a thing. And I was like, in that next moment, literally not blasphemous, oh God, help me, okay? And so I looked at my wife, and she was having to be at an appointment. And I looked at her and I said, can you take me home? Graciously, you know? And she replied, well, what choice do I have? You know, what choice do I have? You're my wife. And so we hopped in the vehicle that was open, and we started to drive back up Ocean Heights and, you know, go towards our house. And so I dropped her off at her appointment, went to the house, got the other set of keys. Thank goodness they were in the right place. Came on driving back down at Ocean Heights, and I realized something. And this is how God speaks to me a lot of times through my stupidity and different things that I do in my life. And all of a sudden, the whole thought process was, in that moment of locking my keys in a running vehicle, okay, running vehicle, is I needed a savior. I needed someone to deliver me. I was in a predicament that, left to myself, I could not get myself out of. Now, I know some of you are like, yeah, Pastor, like, you could walk home. Yeah, right, you know? Imagine seeing me walking up Ocean Heights, okay? All of you would drive by. You're like, I ain't picking that guy up because I have no idea what he just did. You know, like, why is he walking up Ocean Heights? Frigid cold outside, getting home and walking. It just, you know, I needed a savior. I needed a deliverer. In that moment, in that situation, in that illustration, that was my wife. Now, I could have come inside and I could have got one of the staff members that were working incredibly hard and said, hey, I need you to take me home and I need you to drop my wife off. But I was able to have Danielle be my savior. I thought about that in our different lives. I think that we need saviors in different places. Now, I know it's a Christmas Eve service and, you know, you're ready to hear about Jesus, but let's kind of put that on the side for now, and let's examine different places in our life that we potentially need saviors, places that we're unable to help ourselves. Now, I think of physically, I think of emotionally, and I think of spiritually, okay? So physically, what are those things that you've been in your life that you're unable to help yourself? I think about my sister. My sister has had three different bouts of cancer. She's had leukemia when she was 5 years old. She had multiple brain tumors when she was in her early 20s. And then she had thyroid cancer when she was in her late 20s. Every single one of those, she needed some form of intervention. Now, the miracle is she was supposed to die because of the leukemia, and she didn't. I believe God spared her life. This was in South Africa, very different medical technology in the 80s. When she had her brain tumors, she's got two different results, one with five brain tumors and one with two. Three of them disappeared after a time of praying and fasting. So there was both medical intervention and there was both godly intervention in those places. But where do you need a savior physically? I think some of us right now are thinking about those New Year's resolutions. You know, you're thinking like, if I can just lose weight in 2017, I'll be better. You know, if I could just get to the gym, I'll be better. If I could just lose a few inches, I'd be better. If I could just be more disciplined. You know, physically, we can keep on talking about that. I mean, a savior in, if I can just get my education, a savior, let's talk about relationally, like in our lives. How many times do we think, if I could just get this, if I could just get him, if I could just get her, if I could just outget that person, if I could just figure out this relational situation, then everything's going to be all right. Like, I need a savior. And yet many of us know that once we get that person, once that relationship happens, then there's still challenges that we'll face. Think about emotionally or mentally. You know, think about where you're at when you're emotional and you just need someone to talk you off the edge. Hi, my name's Brendan. I've got three kids and I often need to be talked off the edge. Any other parents out there? Like, I need help in that way. But we need a savior. We need a deliverer. It's like, honey, I need some help. Like, deliver me from this situation, or, you know, get me out of this situation. Someone talk me off the edge. And then, so, you know, there's mentally, there's relationally, there's spiritually, and there's different saviors that we could have, different people that could help us because we're unable to help ourselves. Much like me, you know, locking the keys in a running vehicle. Now, here's the thought process. I'm driving down Ocean Heights, and I'm having this vision of my vehicle overheating, and no one in the church caring about it, and coming around and literally seeing plumes of smoke just a few days before Christmas coming out of my vehicle. You know, I needed a savior to have that not happen at that moment. But let's talk about spiritually, because we've talked about relationally, we've talked about mentally, we've talked about physically, we've talked about emotionally, but spiritually, because we're made up of a spirit being. We've made up of a soul. We have a mind. We have a will. We have emotions. We've made up of this flesh over here. Sometimes it does the right things. Sometimes it doesn't do the right things. But spiritually, I, Brendan, let's talk about myself for a moment. I recognize the depths of my own depravity. I just do. I recognize that left to myself, I am often no good. Left to myself, take my incredible wife, take an amazing church, take a group of mentors and brothers that speak into my life. Like, take all of those people away and just leave Brendan by himself. Can I be honest? Like, I'm left to my own depravity. In fact, let me just take a step forward and be even more honest. Like, when my wife goes out of town, I freak out because I don't want to be alone. I'm like, hey, I don't like you going away for that amount of time because, you know, left to myself, I'm no good. I need a savior in my life. Just as much as 2 days ago, I needed a savior for my vehicle, I need a spiritual savior. Now, many of us tonight, we know that that would be Jesus Christ at the end of the day. But I also recognize that there are a lot of us here that are still trying to figure out this journey. That there are some of us saying, hey, I'm just here because I drove in from Pennsylvania and I'm having dinner at my mom's house and I have no choice but to be here tonight. And that's right. Like, I respect that. That's a value of this church, is that we would be a safe place. That we would work hard to be a safe place for you to explore this relationship with Jesus Christ. However, I think I would say that as we've talked about some of these illustrations, that we would come to a conclusion that at some point in our life, every one of us would need a Savior. We would just need a Savior. We need someone to be able to deliver us. But I would go a step further and say the most important place that you and I would require a Savior is because of Jesus Christ. That you and I would need someone to deliver us from the depravity that we have. Now, I have the privilege of being honest tonight. Like, that's my job, to be up here and is to be honest. And I recognize that you're going, hey, I've got it under control. But see, a part of my job is to speak to a lot of people, to have a lot of conversations, to do a lot of counseling. At the end of the day, it boils down to us and who we are and those decisions that we make. In fact, if we go back to the Old Testament, I mean, I use the Bible as a guide for me. And so there's the Old Testament and there's the New Testament. The coming of Jesus is really the fulfillment of the Old Testament. The Old Testament is man trying to make it happen. And guess what? He just can never make it happen. And so then God needs to send his son, Jesus Christ, to be our Savior, to be our deliverer. Now, the word Savior comes from one scripture that's found in the book of Deuteronomy, so kind of right towards the beginning of the Old Testament. And the illustration is a young lady that's in a field, and there's a gentleman that's about to do some inappropriate things to her, and the law of the land was set up to be able to protect that lady that was in the fields. In fact, Deuteronomy, it's not on the screens, but just listen to it. Deuteronomy chapter 22, verse 27 says, where the law anticipated a situation when no deliverer was near in a time of need. I thought that was interesting. Where the law anticipated a situation when no deliverer was near in the time of need. Now, yeah, use the illustration of me locking the keys in a running vehicle. That there was no deliverer until I said, honey, I need your help. In the context of Deuteronomy in the Old Testament, is this young girl was about to be raped. And there was no deliverer. There was no individual that was there in a time of need. And what they decided is that there needed to be a Savior. There needed someone to be able to step into that circumstance. Now, if we carry that all the way back into the New Testament, which is the coming of Christ, the start of the early church, the redemption of the world, we go back and we look at Luke chapter 2, verse 11. We talked about this last week at ACIT. And in Luke chapter 2, verse 11, it says, for today in the city of David, there has been born to you, what's that word? Savior, who is? Christ the Lord. In fact, let's everyone, all campuses together, online, even if you're watching, let's read it together. For today, in the city of David, there has been born for you a Savior who is Christ the Lord. See, there, that word Savior, let's go back to Deuteronomy in the Old Testament. That there was an anticipation of God that there would be no deliverer for us spiritually when we were in a time of need. Now, we're in this series called His Story is My Story, and so on social media, we've been sharing a lot of stories of people's encounters with Jesus. We talked about this last week, that everyone comes from different circumstances, different situations, different economic standards, different racial backgrounds, different cultural backgrounds. But at the end of the day, they have each recognized that there was no anticipated Savior until they reached out to Jesus Christ. That's what Luke chapter 2, the writer, Luke the physician, is looking in and saying, hey, there was a Savior, there was a deliverer, there was someone that in your moment of need was able to reach out to you. See, we just talked about that. There was an anticipated situation when no one was there, and then in a moment there was a deliverer. Now, you could have walked all the way up Ocean Heights when it was freezing cold, but why not take the ride? Why not say, honey, can I drop you off at that appointment and then I can go get the vehicle? The same goes back to our spirituality. The same goes back to the depravity that left to our own what we think, what we come up with, the things that run through our mind, the loneliness that plagues us. The feelings of I'm not good enough. The feelings of I'm never going to be able to make it. Left to ourselves, that depravity will destroy us. And so that's Luke chapter 2, verse 11. But let's go to that first book of the New Testament, the book of Matthew. The book of Matthew chapter 1, verse 21 says, she, Mary, will bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus. Then it says this, for he will save his people from their sins. That word save comes from that word savior. That Mary was the chosen individual to bring Christ into this world. But there was an instruction that was given that you were to name him Jesus, and Jesus would be the savior of the world. Jesus would be the individual that when you are in the field and when you're crying out for help and when you're trying to figure out life and you're trying to figure out those next steps and you're left to yourself, that the law, the word of God, would have placed Jesus as a substitute for the things that were about to happen to you. That's what it's saying right there. So that's Luke, and I know we're going through a lot of scripture, but that's Luke, and then we went to Matthew, and then so come on, let's just like hit all the Gospels nearly in the New Testament. The book of John says this, John 4, verse 40, totally different circumstance, but I'll explain it afterwards. John chapter 4, verse 40 says, so when the Samaritans came to Jesus, they were asking him to stay with them, and he stayed with them for 2 more days. Many more believed because of his word. So there was something happening. They were believing, verse 42. And they were saying to the woman, that was the Samaritan woman, it is no longer because of what you said that we believe. This is so important. For we have heard for ourselves and know that this one, capital one, okay, Jesus, is indeed, what's that word? Savior. What's that word? Come on, one more time, a little louder. What's that word? Savior, okay? This one indeed is the Savior. What does it go on to say? Let's read it together. Of the world. He is the deliverer. He is the one that is going to save. So you're saying, hey, listen, I have no idea what you just said. That's all right, okay? So I'm here to give us context. Now, the Samaritans, like, let's be honest. And I won't offend anyone tonight, but like, you know, it's like the South Jersey, North Jersey thing, okay? Like, you know, like we're South Jersey and the Samaritans, like, you know, they were the other people. Now, in the context, the Samaritans were a similar religious sect, but they were very much despised by the Jews. They were the other people, okay? So imagine Jesus says, hey, I am going to spend time with the other people. And the other people don't even know about me. The other people have no concept, man, I get excited, that the law in the Old Testament has established a Savior, and the Savior is me. And Jesus goes and spends time with this Samaritan woman. Now, context is the Samaritan woman is the lady that goes to a well in the middle of the day. It's hot. Noonday sun. She shouldn't be doing that. She's either going in the morning or she's going in the evening. But this woman, because she's had multiple divorces, this woman, because she's been with multiple men, this woman, because she's with a man now and that they're not even married. I mean, it's just this whole history. She's so ashamed to be able to go at the regular time that she goes at the time when it's the hottest in the day and she has an encounter with Jesus. If you're from Fusion, do you remember like in the summer we did that whole series on encounters? Like the Samaritan woman, the far from Jesus, the messed up, the one trying to figure out relationships, the one that desperately needs a savior, all of a sudden has an encounter with Jesus, the savior. Her encounter is so radical that she goes back to this Samaritan village And like she is on social media, she is checking in with Jesus, she is like selfie FaceTiming, I mean, she's Instagramming live what's going on, and all of a sudden, the whole town realizes what's going on. And then right there, they make this powerful statement. They say, it's no longer because of the lady. It's no longer because of the crazy woman. It's no longer because of that woman or the messed up stuff in her life. No. We have come to a conclusion. The Samaritans, the people that are not even Jews, the ones where there's enmity between them, there's rivalry between them. I mean, we've come to a conclusion. And they say this, that we've come to the conclusion that the one is indeed the Savior of the world, the Redeemer of the world, the Deliverer of the world. When I read that, it says God has a plan for my life. That no matter where I'm at, no matter what I'm going through, no matter how many keys I've locked in a running car, no matter what balls I've dropped in this Christmas season, no matter how dark or how bright my life is, because I've realized this, if it's bright now, it's going to get dark later. And then here's some hope. If it's dark now, what's going to happen? It's got to get bright. Okay, the sun's got to come up. Go ahead, tell your neighbor, the sun's got to come up. Because here's the reality for Christmas Eve for me. 9 years ago, living in Phoenix, Arizona, we were doing something in the house, and all of a sudden we realized we needed just a gallon of milk. You ever had that happen? Like, there's no milk. And so all of a sudden, I ran to Walgreens that was maybe a quarter of a mile away. And I'm in Walgreens, and I've got a gallon of milk, and I'm walking to the cash register, and my phone rings. 9 years ago, Christmas Eve. And as the phone rings, I feel the Spirit of God say, your dad has died. There was no prompting of why I would feel that. And as I pick up the number and I say, hello, it's a gentleman on the other side that says, you don't know who I am, but this is my name. I'm a friend of John Wilson. And I just want to let you know that John Wilson died today. And I'm so sorry. And I said, thank you. And I said, you know, can I make sure that I've got your number? He was calling from South Africa, and I wrote that down. And as I went to the cash register, the lady with the Christmas hat on, all goofy and excited, and got way too much caffeine and Monster Energy drink in her, is like, Merry Christmas, Merry Christmas. And I just looked at her and I said, my dad died. And her face just goes blank. And in that moment, when so much of my past comes crashing in, so much of what I've lived through growing up, so much of the divorce in my family, so much of the addictions, so many of the issues that come raging into my life. And as I drive home and as I walk in, as I tell my wife and as I'm broken with emotion, I am so desperate for a Savior because there was no word that you could have given me in that moment to make me all right. In the midst of the greatest tragedy that I was facing in that time, everything else was beautiful. I had a young boy that had just been born a few months ago. Our marriage was incredible. We were part of an amazing church, but yet that moment, I desperately needed a Savior. In that moment, there was no one that could speak to me and say it was going to be all right, but only the very presence of God, only the law that was established in the Old Testament that was brought forth in the New Testament was able to redeem my pain. And maybe for you today, it's not death, but it's a broken marriage. Maybe for you, it's not a broken marriage today, but it's a broken family. Maybe for you, it's not a broken family, but it's broken finances. Maybe for you, it's not broken finances, but it's a broken addiction. Maybe it's not a broken addiction, but it's something in your past that you've never addressed, you've never dealt with. And I know this, left to our own, our depravity will destroy us. It's what most of the Old Testament is about. They tried to get themselves right with God, and they just couldn't do it. They tried everything, and it was crazy underneath the sun until God came to a conclusion, as it says in John 3:16, that God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son as a redeemer and as a savior for you and I. That day on the Christmas Eve of Eve 9 years ago, and what I've remembered every single year since then, and today texting and going back with my family in South Africa and the half-sisters and brothers that I have, and trying to share the love of Christ, to say that at the end of the day, there is a Savior. At the end of the day, when everything else looks right, that inside there is something that needs to change. Because I can go back and left to myself out of a divorce, left to myself out of various addictions, left to myself out of what my family had done to me, left to myself in growing up in Southern Africa, I would have destroyed myself. But unless there was a destiny and a plan and a purpose of God. And so we've looked at Luke and we've looked at Matthew, and man, we've gone all the way back to Deuteronomy, and you know, then we've gone to John. So like one more scripture before we close. It's a little known book towards the end of the New Testament. The guy's name is Titus. And Titus had some crazy words to say to us. And in Titus chapter 3, verse 4, it says, "But when the kindness of God our Savior and his love for mankind appeared." Think about that. The love of mankind was Jesus coming. That's what we celebrate in this Christmas season. Verse 5 says, he saved us. He saved us. He redeemed us. He was a savior. It says, not on the basis of deeds, trying to do good, which we have been trying to do in righteousness, but it says this, but according to his mercy, by the washing of the regeneration and renewing by the Holy Spirit. I know that's super complicated, but it's simply saying that he is the savior in our life, that he gives us a vision and a destiny. Verse 6 is this, whom he poured out upon us richly through Jesus Christ our Savior, so that being justified by his grace, that we would be made children, sons and daughters, according to the hope of eternal life. Now, we don't have time to get into that, but literally to sum that up is that Christ is our Savior. That Christ is the one that redeemed us. That Christ is the one that takes that challenge that you're going through. Christ is the one that takes that insecurity, and let's just be so honest today, is he takes the sin, the muck and the junk in our life, and he places it upon himself. That's another story for another time. That's the Easter celebration. But one of the things that I'm convinced of in the beginning of 2017 is to take the first few weeks out of 2017 and have a title of a message series called Dream Again. Dream Again. I'm just talking to way too many people that have lost their dreams. Way too many people that have lost their dreams in their families or their marriages. Way too many people that have lost their dreams of what God has literally placed from the creation of the world inside of you to accomplish, and yet you've lost it. And it comes back to what Titus says right there. He says that God has poured himself out on you richly. I have no idea what your Christmas season is going to look like. But I can tell you this one thing. 9 years ago, there was a Savior in my life. On the 3rd of October, 1992, in a small, tiny farming town on the backside of South Africa, I encountered a Savior. I had no clue what was going to happen in my life. I had no clue the highs and the lows, what I would see and what I would be placed through. And yet, through every single one of those, there's been a Savior. There's been someone, according to what Deuteronomy said, that was designated by the law to be your redeemer. Then in a moment of desperation, that person, that Savior, that Christ would be there to reach out to you. And tonight, today, each of us has that privilege. Each of us has that opportunity to be able to make that decision. We're going to finish with one last song. You received a glow stick, and the song is called Noel. As we sing this song together, as we stand in all our locations together, my simple prayer for you, that in these next few minutes, that you would just simply have a moment. Have a moment of saying, where is that in my life that I need a Savior? Where is that I've never made a decision? Where is that I'm fighting or I'm wrestling with? Where is that I have not surrendered to? As they begin to sing, come on, let's go ahead and break those glow sticks. Let's lift them high as we sing this song together. God bless you.